Good evening to all of you. In our last lecture, we have seen the functions in C++, inline functions, default argument to the functions, and the concept of function overloading. Today, we are going to study the next chapter about classes and objects. How do we define classes in C++? How do we create objects in C++? Before going to the concept of classes in C++, we will just revise the concept of structures, okay, in C programming language. So what do you mean by a structure in C programming language? A structure is a collection of different data items stored in a continuous memory location. So it can store different types of values inside it. Consider a structure for student which has three fields, that is name of string type, that is character, roll number of integer type, and total marks of the student of float type. It means three different types of values are now stored into a student structure, a student object. So how do you create the object of the student structure? So this is the line by which we can create the object or the variable of structure student. Struct student, capital A is the variable of student type. So it is a user defined type now. In C programming language, every structure terminates with a semicolon. Then how to create object and access the members of the structure? To access the member of the structure, we use object dot the field name or variable dot the field name. So if I want to access name, I have to write a dot name like this. Here string copy a dot name, right? If I want to access roll number, I have to write a dot roll number. If I want to access total marks, I have to write a dot total marks. So this is the way we access the structure variables. There is the limitation of C structure is that all the members of the structure are by default public. So anyone can access from outside the members of the structure. Data is not secured in C programming language. That's why C++ provides us an extension of structure that is called a class. In a class, we can declare variables as well as functions inside a class. This is a simple declaration of a class here. If you see the syntax of class, it consists of two parts, private and public section, where we can declare variables as well as functions inside both these sections. Every class also terminates with semicolon, similar to the C structures, but here by default all the members of the class are private. So this is the advantage of C++ programming language. It gives more importance to the data security. All the variables declared inside the class are called as data members, and all the functions declared inside the class are called as member functions. So here onwards we are not going to call variables, we are going to call it as data member of the class, and functions are called as member functions of the class. Now we'll see private section of the class and what do you mean by public section of the class. All the members which are declared inside the private area cannot be accessed outside the class. Nobody from outside the class cannot have direct access to the private area. Okay. Now we'll see the use of the public area. The variable or functions declared inside the public area can be accessible by anyone outside the class. So there is a direct access provided to the public section, right? Even the object of the class in C++ cannot have direct access to the data members declared inside the private area. If anyone wants to access the data members or inside the private area, they have to access it via the member function defined to the public section. Okay. there is a data security provided in C++. Remember one thing about the variable declaration and function declaration inside the class. Variable declared inside the class are called as data members, and function declared inside the class are called as member functions. And how to create the object of the class? The similar way we created the structure variable, the same way we create the object of the class. So this is a small example given here on a simple use of a class atom, which has two members inside the private area. If the visibility mode, that is private or public keyword, is missing, by default all the members are considered as private. So here in this class declaration, the integer, number and float cost are considered into the private area. In public area, we have defined declared two functions to read the data inside number and cost, and then the another function is taken, that is put data, which is going to used to display the value inside the number and cost value, and it terminates with semicolon here. Now we'll see how to create the objects of the class. The objects of the class item are created like this. Here one example is given. Before closing the class, x, y and z are declared. It means there are three objects of item class has been created here. Now we'll see how to access the members of the class through the object of the class. We have to use the object name and dot operator here like this, and call the member functions of the class. That is, in this case it is put data. X dot put data is nothing but here x is the object and put data is the member functions of the class. Similarly, if I want to access get data, I have to write x dot get data function. Now, how to define member functions of the class? This is a very important point. Of defining a member function, we can define member function inside the class, or we can define a member function outside the class definition. Now we'll see how to define a member function inside the class. Inside the class declaration definition is very simple. The way we normally define the function, the same way we define the function inside the class. But whenever we define the function, member function outside the class, we have to use the syntax like this. First of all, we have to write return type, then class name, scope resolution operator, then function name, argument list and the function body. Correct. So what is newly added into this syntax is only two things that have been added into the function definition line, that is class name and scope resolution operator. What do you mean by scope resolution operator? These four dots, right? Here this operator is called as scope resolution operator. What this scope resolution operator tells the compiler that this function belongs to this class name, right? So this way we can define, by using this syntax, we can define the function outside the class. If suppose I want to define a get data function which was defined previously outside the class, I have to write the function definition for get data like this: void class name, that is item, then scope resolution operator, and the get data function definition, where it has two parameters A and B. A goes to number and B goes to cost. So here, just remember one thing: whenever we define any member function outside the class, I have to add two things into the function header line. That is called, after return type, we have to write the class name and then scope resolution operator and the function name. Okay, and the function body after that. So if you see here, the function definition inside the class for a member function. In this class item, if you focus on put data function here, this function definition put data inside the class is called as member function definition inside the class. And we have defined it normally, the way we did previously, that is normal function definition, right? but without the use of the class name and scope resource object. That is needed only when we define the function outside the class. Now we'll see the first example of using a class and member function definition inside the class and member function definition outside the class. So this is our first program using class, which has two fields, that is number and cost. There are two member functions defined, declared and defined inside the class and outside the class. In public area, if you see, get data function was just declared here, and later on it was defined outside the class. Put data function was defined inside the class, which is responsible for displaying the value of number and cost here. Now get data function just declared, and if I want to define outside the class, I have to use this header line. Void, that is the return type of the get data function, then class name, scope resistance operator, get data function name, and then parameters, and then the function body. So this way we define the function outside the class. Now if you see, after the class declaration, all the member functions are defined, and at last we write the main program. Inside the main program, first of all we need to create the object of the class to access the members of the class. Without the object, I cannot access the member functions or members of the class, right? So I have to create the object X, and through that object X, I can call the function get data and put data like this. X dot get data. I have to pass two parameters to the get data function, that is number and cost. And X dot put data function is used to display the values of number and cost variable. There is one more object created here in the program, that is item Y. Item is the class name, Y is the object here. Again, another we call the function get data with another value is 200 and some 175.50. Here Y dot put data will display the values inside this Y object, that is number and cost of that particular object. So we see the output of this program. You will find there are two objects have been created and displayed on the screen with the help of get data and put data function. Get data function is used to read the values inside the object, and put data function is used to display the values of the object. You can give any name to input function and output function, like get data for reading, read function, input function, right? So it is just a user defined name. So this ends the first program on the class. Now I'll stop the session here. Your task is to perform this program. Create one class, take some variables, read the values inside the variable, then take another function which is responsible for displaying the values of the object. Okay. Try to create 2-3 objects, read the values into the objects of the class and display it on the screen. You can post your code in the chat room, or also you can upload it on the course networking in our group MCA_OOP_2017-2018. We'll stop here for 5 minutes. You perform it and you upload the code.